Christ has risen. He has risen indeed. Alleluia. A hugely warm welcome to you, whoever you are, wherever you are watching this. We are so pleased that you've been able to join us for worship today. On Monday evenings, beginning on the 19th of April, we'll be running the Alpha course online. This is a chance to explore some of those very, very big questions of life and of faith. We would love it if you were able to join us. If you'd like to know more and to register, please do get in touch with us. hello@queenstreet.org.uk or through social media. Welcome to worship. Whether it's in the blazing sunshine or the freezing cold snow, we love seeing what you've been up to. Let's have a look at your photos from this week.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name, sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name, sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again.
Let us pray. Loving Father, all the fancy words in the world cannot compete with a heartfelt sorry when we have no other words. There are times when we are all too aware of our limitations, conscious of sin and the distance it creates between us. Sometimes sorry is the only word we can say out loud. We take a moment now to say sorry. Thank you. It is only you who can read and understand the language of our hearts. Only you who can translate sorry into the prayer we would have prayed if we had the words within us. Then you forgive, and having forgiven, surround us in an embrace of love, drawing us close to your heart. Thank you, loving Father, that you listen to hearts as well as voices. Thank you, Lord God, for the opportunity of worship, for the freedom to share together in the warmth of your embrace. Thank you that in worship we can put aside the uncertainties of this world and rest upon the certainty of you. For your promises are not changeable, but immovable and eternal. Thank you that we can bring to you, to your feet, all the hurts and fears that trouble us, and leave them there, knowing that your strength and assurance are all that we require. Thank you that as we draw near in worship, we are transported from a world of concerns and fears to a place where we can be at peace in your presence, finding healing, wholeness and refreshment. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The reading is taken from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand in his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands, reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to them, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. Amen.
Hello, it really is a delight to be able to share with you. I should present myself. My name is Ian Horne. I am a Yorkshireman. I grew up in Selby, near York. And actually, my parents lived for many years in Scarborough. That's how we got to know Louis Atkinson and a late husband, Pastor Fred, who's a wonderful man of faith. So I've been serving in Latin America for about 15 years with my wife, Juliana, who's Colombian. We have two adolescent boys. We have many years working in Peru, but for the last 2 years, we've been based in Colombia, and we're ministering to Venezuelan migrants. You'll have heard of the terrible situation in Venezuela. Well, Colombia has received close to 1 million migrants over the past number of years. So we have a ministry which seeks to accompany them, help them to settle in Bogota, challenge them in faith, and also attends to their practical needs, rental, income generation, health issues, food, things like that. It's a very rewarding and at the same time a very challenging ministry. Well, I do hope that you all had a wonderful and uplifting Easter. As Christians, we are part of a resurrection movement, aren't we? We are called to constantly celebrate that Jesus is alive, that he has conquered death and sin, and that he is Lord of the whole world. The text we're looking at today is John 20 from verse 19 onwards. Jesus has already appeared in resurrected form to Mary Magdalene at the tomb. And now in our text, he appears to the disciples. It's obvious that he is physically different. He is somehow able to enter a locked room. Yet at the same time, he's able to show his disciples the scars of the crucifixion, the marks on his hand, the point in his side where the soldier drove in the spear. And it's really important to pick up the context of this text, because the disciples are really totally dominated by fear. Here they are meeting behind locked doors for fear of the Jews. They know that as the main followers of Jesus, as his disciples, they could easily be picked out and they could end up suffering the same fate as their master. So fear is the dominating theme amongst the disciples. It's often been said, hasn't it, that love makes the world go round. But also I once read somebody saying that actually fear of death is what makes the world go round. It's so true, isn't it, that as human beings we can let ourselves be controlled by fears, not only as individuals, but as societies, as communities. And of course, this COVID-19 pandemic is a big example, how it's brought fear or increased the fear in our lives. Do you remember the panic buying at the beginning of the pandemic? And then there's all the fear of infection and death, of losing employment, of losing loved ones. And of course, we've seen a lot of irrational behavior, and fear has fueled mental health problems. I remember a few months ago seeing a lady who was who I would call a compulsive sprayer. I saw this lady in a local supermarket, and she had lots of small bags, and each product that she took off the shelf she would spray, and then she would spray the inside of the bag, and then she would pack the product inside the bag and she would spray the whole bag on the outside. It just shows you the extremes that we can be driven to. So I hope in this text today that we can see how Jesus' resurrection brings good news, brings hope for all of us who are trapped in our fears. First thing we notice as Jesus appears to his disciples is that his presence with them brings immense joy. The text says that they were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Jesus is alive and he is with us all the time, eternally, as he has said, until the end of the age, and his presence brings joy. Another thing that we can note in the text is the way Jesus greets the disciples. He actually uses a very normal, common greeting of the time, Shalom Aleichem, which literally means peace be with you. But we notice that Jesus deliberately repeats it. He repeats it twice with all the disciples. And then the following week, when Thomas is there, he repeats the same greeting. We need to remember that biblically, peace is not just about feeling calm and untroubled. Peace is about enjoying reconciled, harmonious and fruitful relationships. Firstly with God, then with others, then with his creation and even with ourselves. Peace is based on harmonious relationships. First of all, with God. And surely as Jesus repeated this greeting, his disciples were thinking about his teaching. Because earlier in this gospel, Jesus had told them he was going to give them a lasting peace, which had a totally different quality to the world's peace. Look what he says in John 14:27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And then later on in John 16:38, he tells them how this peace would be a result of his victory. Listen to what he says. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. And we know how the cross was his victory over death and sin, and opened up a whole new possibility of existence for us as believers. So we have Jesus' presence bringing joy. We have Jesus bringing a peace that can overcome our fears. And then we see a text which is very important, which is in verse 21. Jesus says to the disciples, as the Father has sent me, I am sending you. What a contrast here. Now you can imagine these men cowering, hiding in this room, full of fear. And yet Jesus comes to send them out into the world, not to hide from the world, but to go out in the world in the power of the Spirit to love and heal and serve as Jesus did. What a contrast. What a difference the Holy Spirit can make in our lives. And of course, as a missionary, I can't help observe that this is a key text for mission of the church. Basically, when Jesus says, as the Father has sent me, I am sending you, he is presenting himself as a model for our mission. The way he wanted to lead people to Heavenly Father, the way he loved, the way he served sacrificially, the way he restored others. All of these things are models for our mission as Christians. And then we see how the living, resurrected Lord sends each one of us out in the power of the Spirit. At the end of the day, the Spirit itself is a manifestation of the resurrection power. And so Jesus sends us out as well. He's not only the model for our mission, he also sends each one of us out to continue his ministry in the world. Perhaps this pandemic has reminded us how fragile we are, how weak we are as human beings, how much we need our Creator, how much we need each other for that matter too. And in the midst of our fears and our doubts, Christ comes to us. Let's continue to rejoice, to revel in the resurrection. We can say with certainty that Jesus is alive, that he has risen, that he has overcome. The text we're looking at today gives us great hope. Jesus' resurrection not only assures us of our destiny, our eternal destiny, but his resurrection assures us of his presence, his peace, and his purpose for our lives. I just would like to finish this short message with a challenge. It's a challenge for myself, and it's a challenge for you. Do you know God's peace at this time? Do you know this peace that passes all understanding? Are you experiencing this peace that calms your heart and mind? These times are difficult. These times are stressful. These times are uncertain. Perhaps some of us are feeling a bit of confusion or vulnerable. Perhaps you've lost your self-esteem. I don't know how you respond to this situation, but I know that when I'm troubled, my way of responding is often to get involved in intense activity, to kind of displace the pain and displace the concern. I get involved in lots of activity. But I'm realizing this isn't the way. This isn't the way to really truly experience God's peace. And I don't think there's anything new in what I'm going to say. It's just a reminder. If we really want to experience this deep peace, let's seek God. Let's get on our knees. Let's cast our cares on him, because he cares so much for each one of us. Let's call out to him. Let's remember not to focus on the bad things, but to give him thanks for the good things that are happening each day. Let's give ourselves in worship to God. Let's take time to be still before him as well. Let's dig into his word, and for each day, get some living word. Christ has promised us his peace. Let's claim it. Let's experience it. And really, my prayer for all of you in these coming months is that you may know God's peace in a special way. God bless you.
So this morning, in responding to Ian's message, I want to encourage you to stop and to spend time quietly before God, seeking his peace. Hold your fears before him, and the God who brought Jesus back from the dead has the power of transformation in your life. So take some time to quietly seek God, to seek his peace, and to say, Lord, I want to know your peace more. Let's halt our busyness, let's halt the mind fog, and let's seek the clarity of God's peace. Let's pray. Father God, we come before you to be still, and we commit this week to spending time each day silently seeking you. We ask for your peace so that we would know you more, so that we would be free of our fears, and so that we'd be ready to go out and do your work. Amen.
Dear Lord, we bring our prayers for other people. With our minds so focused on grief, with the death of Prince Philip this week, we pray for the family of Prince Philip, and we pray for anybody who is suffering from grief at this moment, anyone who's lost somebody, anybody who just can't quite get over the loss of somebody recently or in the distant past. We pray for your healing in those lives. And we pray for the royal family as they go through such a public outpouring of love, and yet they've got to grieve in their own way. We pray for your peace in that family this week and beyond. And Lord, we pray for the continued effects of the COVID-19 pandemic. We pray that the vaccine programs across the world will continue to thrive. And Lord, we think of countries where the pandemic is really out of control, specifically Brazil and parts of Europe and the US, where the virus really is ravaging communities. We pray for healthcare systems in all of these countries and across the world. And Lord, we pray for people's livelihoods. We pray that people will continue to return to work as we face a new level of restriction this week, a relaxing of what we've seen before. We pray this will be successful and will be safe. And we thank you, Lord, for the scientists who've made the vaccine possible, the medical professionals who've responded so well. We thank you for all the blessings of the professionals who've made such a difference in such a difficult time. And Lord, we pray for ourselves and our families. We pray that our own situation will improve, that your healing power will be in our families. And we pray for our church, Lord. We pray that as we return to face-to-face meetings of services and youth groups and community groups, we pray that you will be there, keeping everybody safe. We love you, Lord, and we ask all these prayers because we know you listen. We ask them in and through your name. We love you, Lord. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us for worship this week. Please do join us again next week as we begin a new mini-series on the parables of Jesus. We'd love it if you could join us again. In the meantime, if you need anything at all, prescriptions, shopping or just a chat, please do get in touch with us. Hello at queenstreet.org.uk, through social media or just on the phone. We would love to hear from you. We finish with the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. See you next week.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Promise good to me, His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion me as long as life endures. My chains are forever mine. You are forever.